I welcome you to the second session of Physical World. In the last class, we had seen what is science, what is physics. Also, we have seen physics or science in general is dynamic. Any theory of science is not final. It goes on changing as new and new discoveries are going on. Today, we shall see the scope and excitement of physics. Scope of physics is vast, as I already told you. How much vast it is, that let us see now. Physics can be divided into classical physics and modern physics. What is classical physics? It deals with macroscopic phenomena at laboratory, terrestrial and astronomical scales. Means it deals with different phenomena which we can see. In the laboratory we can do it. In the laboratory we can see it. Or terrestrial means on earth. On earth we see different phenomena, as I explained in the last class. Also astronomical scales. Astronomy, all of you know, means it is about the sky, about the space, that is about planets, stars, galaxy, etc. We study in classical physics. Means all these are macroscopic. Then this includes branches like mechanics, electrodynamics, optics and thermodynamics. Mechanics means it deals with motion. Vastugala chalane mechanics alli nodte. Electromagnetics, it deals with motion of electric charges. Optics deals with light and phenomena related to it. Thermodynamics deals with heat and its flow. Then, what is modern physics? We shall see. Modern physics deals with microscopic phenomena. Microscopic means we cannot see with our eyes. It includes branches like atomic physics, nuclear physics, radiation physics, condensed matter physics. So atomic physics, it deals with atoms. Atoms means how much small they are. I will explain that one using a cube. Let us consider a cube. Let us imagine a small cube of 1 cubic centimeter. Ondu sanna ghana, ondu ಸಣ್ಣ ಘನ ತಾಮ್ರದ್ದು ಅಂತ ತೆಗೊಳ್ಳುವ. ಲೆಟ್ ಅಸ್ ಕನ್ಸಿಡರ್ ಎ ಕಾಪರ್ ಕ್ಯೂಬ್ ಆಫ್ 1 cubic centimeter, 1 ಘನ centimeter ಗಾತ್ರದ್ದು. ಬಹಳ ಚಿಕ್ಕದು, ಇಷ್ಟೇ ಚಿಕ್ಕದು. ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಎ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಕ್ಯೂಬ್ ಹೌ ಮೆನಿ ಆಟಮ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ದೇರ್ ಡು ಯು ನೋ? ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ 10^22 ಆಟಮ್ಸ್. ಆರ್ಡರ್ ಇಸ್ 10^22. ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟ್ರೈ 22 ಜೀರೋಸ್ ಇನ್ ಫ್ರಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಒನ್. ಹೌ ಮಚ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್. The number is very big, means the size of the atom is very, very small. It is very difficult to imagine. Then each atom is made up of nucleus at the center, and surrounding that there are electrons. Nucleus, small nucleus at the center, contains protons and neutrons. So how much small they are, protons and neutrons. Then surrounding them, there are still small electrons revolving in different orbits. So these particles are how much small? It is impossible to see them. These are microscopic. At the same time, in physics, we study, in classical physics, we study motion of planets around the sun. And we study about stars, galaxies, etc. All these are macroscopic. What about the size of the earth? Can you imagine the size of the earth? Earth is very big, you know. From here to United States of America, if we want to travel with aeroplane, by aeroplane, then it takes about 24 hours. Then how much big is our earth? But our earth is small compared to our solar system. In this solar system, there are 8 planets including Earth, and Sun is at the center. center of solar system sun. Do you know the size of the sun? In volume, size of the sun is about 5.5 million times that of our earth. You imagine the size of the sun. Surya ishtu doddiddane, namma bhoomiginta 5.5 million pattu doddiddane. Ashtu dodda Surya. Avana bagge naavu adhyayana maadutteve physics nalli. Isteya Suryananu bitre innu Surya annodu samanya nakshatra, eshto nakshatragalu ive. There are many, many stars, and most of the stars which we see in the sky are much greater than, much bigger than our sun. Then all these stars together form a galaxy. This is our galaxy, Milky Way. In Milky Way galaxy, there are about 200 billion stars. I think you know what is 1 billion. 1 billion means 1,000 million. Or 9 zeros in front of 1 is 1 billion. Here, in our galaxy called Milky Way, there are about 200 billion stars. And our sun is an ordinary star in this galaxy. So our galaxy is how much big? From one corner to another corner of the galaxy, that is diameter of the galaxy, is 1 lakh light years. And how much big it is. Such a big galaxy also we study in physics. So starting from small particles up to galaxy, not only even galaxy, our universe, ನಮ್ದು ಇದು ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸಿ ಅಥವಾ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಾಂಡ, ಇದು ಮಿಲ್ಕಿ ವೇ ಅಂತ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ, ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಕಾಶ ಗಂಗೆ, ಹಾಲು ಹಾದಿ, ಕ್ಷೀರಪಥ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಹೆಸರಿದೆ. ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ 200 ಬಿಲಿಯನ್ ನಕ್ಷತ್ರಗಳಿವೆ. ಇದು ಎಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡದಿದೆ? ಇದರ ವ್ಯಾಸ 1 ಲಕ್ಷ ಜ್ಯೋತಿರ್ವರ್ಷ. ಇಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸಿಯ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಕಲಿತೇವೆ. ಇಷ್ಟೇ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಇಂಥಗಳು ಒಂದಲ್ಲ, ಇಂಥ ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸಿಗಳು ಇರುವುದು ಒಂದಲ್ಲ. ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವದಲ್ಲಿ ಇಂಥ ಅಸಂಖ್ಯಾತ ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸಿಗಳಿವೆ. ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸಿಗಳು ಸೇರಿ ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಹಾಗಿದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವ ಎಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡದಿದೆ? ಹೌ ಮಚ್ ಬಿಗ್ ಈಸ್ ಅವರ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸ್? ಅನ್ಕೌಂಟೆಬಲ್ ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಗ್ಯಾಲಾಕ್ಸೀಸ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಅವರ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಸಚ್ ಎ ಬಿಗ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ವಿ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ಇನ್ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ಲಿ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಎಗ್ರಿ that our subject physics is having truly vast scope. It covers tremendous range of magnitudes of physical quantities like length and mass. See, length, starting from size of the electron. See, diameter of the electron is 10^-14 meters, such a small. 10^-14 means 0.1301. Then up to size of the universe, 10^26 meters, means 26 zeros in front of 1, so many meters. So such a small object to such a big object we study in physics. So scope of physics is truly vast. And even mass, starting from mass of the electron, we study up to mass of the visible universe in physics. So mass extends from 10^-30 kg for electron to 10^55 kg for observable universe. So physics is vast, no doubt. Then, how such a small atom or such a small particles like electron, proton, neutron, etc. are studied? We can't see them. But all these things are studied by different experiments, as I have told you in the last class. First observation, then second point is experiments. So different scientists did different experiments to find out the size, the nature, properties of the particles. One scientist, famous scientist, Rutherford, gave nuclear model of atom. Means he discovered nucleus at the center of the atom. How? This is Rutherford who gave nuclear model of atom. How he discovered nucleus inside the atom? Let us see. For that he conducted one experiment called alpha scattering experiment. Rutherford, atom na madhyadalli nucleus ide anta heli kandihidilike ondu alpha ray scattering annu ondu experiment madidru. Aa experiment bagge illi nodi, illi ee slide nalli kaanta irodu adu experiment, adara setup, experimental setup for alpha ray scattering is shown here. Rutherford took one source of alpha particle inside a box having one small slit to come out. So from the slit, from small hole, the beam of alpha particles was coming out, and the beam of alpha particles is made to fall on circular fluorescent screen as shown in the diagram here. Then before falling on the sheet, it is passed through thin gold foil. After passing through thin gold foil, it gets scattered, chadarisalpadutade. Gold foil ina mulaka pass madidaga adu chadarisalpadutade. Here Rutherford observed that most of the charged particles are undeflected and they pass through the gold foil, and only a few particles are deflected as shown in the diagram. So by this experiment and by proper reasoning and using theory, Rutherford came to a conclusion that at the center of every atom there is a small nucleus, and this led to the nuclear model, nuclear atomic model. Then let us see physics, technology and society, how physics is related to technology and society. See, using the principles of physics, technology is developed. For that let us see a few examples. Steam engine was invented by the study of heat and thermodynamics. So this steam engine, this is a technology. This technology is used in trains, as all of you know. So this is a revolution in the field of travel. Then another useful technology, nuclear reactor. Nuclear reactors were developed because of discovery of nuclear fission. About this much detail I won't give you now because it is the first chapter. It should not be too much heavy. Just as an example I am giving all these things, and in detail you will study all these things later. So this is the nuclear, these are nuclear reactors. So these are good energy sources, because nuclear fission you have seen in high school, lot of energy we can get using this. Nuclear fission annodu neevu nodidiri, illi nucleus ninda baruvantaddu, idakke kannadadalli correct shabda nanage gottilla. ಒಂದು ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯಸ್ ಇದ್ದದ್ದು ಅದು ಸ್ಪ್ಲಿಟ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಈ ರಿಯಾಕ್ಷನ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಫಿಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಇದರ ಡಿಟೇಲ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಮತ್ತೆ ಕಲಿತೀರಿ. ಹಾಗೆ ಇಂತಹ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ, ಸ್ಟೀಮ್ ಎಂಜಿನ್ ಆಗಲಿ, ಎಲ್ಲವೂ ಬಂದದ್ದು ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸಿನ ಪ್ರಿನ್ಸಿಪಲ್ಸ್ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸಿ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಆರ್ಟಿಫಿಷಿಯಲ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟಲೈಟ್ಸ್, ಕೃತಕ ಉಪಗ್ರಹಗಳು, ಈ ಕೃತಕ ಉಪಗ್ರಹಗಳು ಒಂದು ಕ್ರಾಂತಿಯನ್ನೇ ಉಂಟು ಮಾಡಿವೆ ಸಂಪರ್ಕ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ. ಆರ್ಟಿಫಿಷಿಯಲ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟಲೈಟ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ರೆವಲ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಇನ್ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಕೇಶನ್ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ. Because now we are using this type of artificial satellites for everything. That is, see, now I am talking here, I am showing you the slides from one place or from a room, from our college. Students sitting in different houses can hear me, can listen me. Also, you can see the presentation what I show. How it is possible? This is because of different technologies, because of electronics, because of computer, because of satellites. See, satellites, without satellites, all these things are not possible. So for all these communications, satellite is the main technology needed, and this is God using physics. Through satellites only, without satellites we cannot watch TV, we cannot use internet, we cannot use mobile phone. Nothing is possible without using satellite. So now it is the age of satellites, and this is the technology obtained from physics, and because of this society is benefited a lot. So physics has contributed a lot in the development of alternating energy sources also. Alternating energy sources means new energy sources, that is wind energy, then wave energy, solar energy, bioenergy. Different sources of energy are discovered now. So physics has contributed a lot for all these types of energies, and every important technological development has the contribution of physics to it. Thus physics has contributed immensely to society. ಈಗ ನಮಗೆ ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಅಥವಾ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಅಥವಾ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೇವೆ, ಅದು ತುಂಬಾ ಅಗತ್ಯ ಇದೆ. ಯಾವುದೇ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಅಥವಾ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಬೇಕು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹೊಸ ಹೊಸ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಶಕ್ತಿಯ ಉತ್ಪಾದನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಗಳು ನಡೀತಾ ಇರುವಾಗ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ನಿಂದ ಹೊಸ ಹೊಸ ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಸೋರ್ಸಸ್, ಶಕ್ತಿಯ ಮೂಲಗಳನ್ನು ಕಂಡುಹಿಡಿದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ಸೊಸೈಟಿಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ಸಮಾಜಕ್ಕೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಪ್ರಯೋಜನ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಈ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕತೆ ಹುಟ್ಟಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಈ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ತುಂಬ ಸಹಕಾರಿಯಾಗಿದೆ. ಇದರ ಹಿಂದೆ, ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿಯ ಹಿಂದೆ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ. ಅದರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಸಮಾಜಕ್ಕೆ ತುಂಬ ಪ್ರಯೋಜನ ಇದೆ. ಈಗ ನಾವು ನೋಡಬೇಕಾದ್ದು, ಈಗ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸಿನ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು ಹೇಳಿ ಆಯಿತು. ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಏನು, ಅದರ ಪ್ರಯೋಜನ ಏನು, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಕೋಪ್ ಏನಿದೆ, ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ನೋಡಿ ಆಯಿತು. ಈಗ ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್, ಇದು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸಿಲೆಬಸ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಆಗಿ ನೀವು ಕಲಿಯಬೇಕಾದ್ದು. ಈ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಾಲ್ಕು ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಇದೆ. ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್. Let us see one by one. The first one is gravitational force, gurutva bala. What is gravitational force? It is the force of attraction between any two bodies in the universe due to their mass. Idannu first kandhiddaddu Newton. This gravitational force was discovered by Newton, and this is applied, this law is applied throughout the universe. As I already told you, Newton stated the law as any two bodies in the universe attract each other by a force which is directly proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. So this force is mainly directly proportional to mass. If the mass of bodies increases, then force increases, and it is inversely proportional to square of the distance. So it decreases with the distance. ಈ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನುವುದು ಮಾಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ದ್ರವ್ಯರಾಶಿಯನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿಕೊಂಡಿದೆ. ಯಾವುದೇ ಈ ವಿಶ್ವದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಯಾವುದೇ ವಸ್ತುವಿಗೆ ಮಾಸ ಯಾವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಉಂಟ ದ್ರವ್ಯರಾಶಿ ಯಾವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಉಂಟ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಗುರುತ್ವ ಇದೆ ಆದರೆ ಮಾಸ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆದಷ್ಟು ಈ ಗುರುತ್ವ ಬಲ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಮಾಸ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆದಷ್ಟು ಕಡಿಮೆ ಇದನ್ನು ನ್ಯೂಟನ್ ನ ಲಾ ನಿಂದ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಬಹುದು ಈಗ ಇದು ನಾನೀಗ ಹೇಳಿದ ಹಾಗೆ ಇಡೀ ವಿಶ್ವದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಭೂಮಿಯ ಮೇಲೆ ವಸ್ತುಗಳು ಬೀಳುವುದು ಕೂಡ ಇದರಿಂದ ಸೂರ್ಯನ ಸುತ್ತ ಭೂಮಿ ಪ್ರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆ ಹಾಕುವುದು ಇದರಿಂದ ಅಥವಾ ನಾನು ಮೊದಲೇ ಹೇಳಿದ ಹಾಗೆ ಸೂಪರ್ ಮಾಸಿವ್ ಬ್ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ ಹೋಲಿನ ಸುತ್ತ ನಕ್ಷತ್ರಗಳು ಸುತ್ತುವುದು ಕೂಡ ಇದರಿಂದ ಹಾಗಿದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಎಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇರಬೇಕು ಇಡೀ ವಿಶ್ವವನ್ನೇ ನಡೆಸ್ತಾ ಇರುವ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ತಪ್ಪಾಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆದರೆ ಇಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೀಕೆಸ್ಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್ ಇದು ಬಹಳ ವೀಕ್ ಇದೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಇದು ವೀಕ್ ಇದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ನಾವೀಗ ನೋಡ್ತೇವೆ ಸಿ ಸಚ್ ಅನ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಈಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಥ್ರೂಔಟ್ ದ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸ್ ಬಿಗ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಅಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಸೂಪರ್ ಮಾಸಿವ್ ಬ್ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ ಹೋಲ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅರ್ತ್ ಇಸ್ ರಿವಾಲ್ವಿಂಗ್ ರೌಂಡ್ ದ ಸನ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಸೊ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಬಿಲೀವ್ ಇಫ್ ಐ ಸೇ ದಿಸ್ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವೀಕೆಸ್ಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್ ದಟ್ ಲೆಟ್ ಮೀ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೈನ್ ಸಿ ಫಾರ್ ಆಲ್ ದೀಸ್ ಮೋಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸೆಲೆಸ್ಟಿಯಲ್ ಬಾಡೀಸ್ gravitational force is needed. So, can you believe that it is the weakest force? Let me explain. Sir Isaac Newton had stated this gravitational force, sorry, gravitational law, and he had discovered this gravitational force. According to his law of gravitation, it is called universal law of gravitation because it is applied throughout the universe. Force F between any two bodies of mass M1 and M2 separated by a distance r is given by F is equal to g m1 m2 over r square. ಎರಡು ವಸ್ತುಗಳು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಎರಡು ನಾವು ಗ್ರಹಗಳು ಅಂತ ತಗೊಳ್ಳಬಹುದು ಅಥವಾ ನಕ್ಷತ್ರಗಳು ಅಂತ ತಗೊಳ್ಳಬಹುದು ಒಂದರ ಮಾಸಿ M1 ಅಂತ ಇರಲಿ ಇನ್ನೊಂದರ ಮಾಸಿ M2 ಅಂತ ಇರಲಿ ದ್ರವ್ಯರಾಶಿ M1 M2 ಅಂತ ಇರಲಿ ಎರಡರದ್ದು ಅದರ ಮಧ್ಯದ ದೂರ R ಅಂತ ಇರಲಿ ಆಗ ಅವುಗಳ ಮಧ್ಯದ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ F ಎಷ್ಟಾಗ್ತದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಇದು ಮ್ಯಾಥಮ್ಯಾಟಿಕಲ್ ಫಾರ್ಮುಲಾ ನ್ಯೂಟನ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟದ್ದು F ಇಸ್ ಈಕ್ವಲ್ ಟು ಜಿ M1 M2 ಓವರ್ R ಸ್ಕ್ವೇರ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಜಿ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಲ್ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ and its value is 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 ಇದು ಇದರ ಆರ್ಡರ್ ಈ ಜಿ ಎಷ್ಟು ಚಿಕ್ಕದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಇದರ ಆರ್ಡರ್ 10 ರ ಘಾತ ಮೈನಸ್ 11 ಅಷ್ಟು ಚಿಕ್ಕದಿದೆ ಆದ್ರಿಂದ ಈ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ತುಂಬಾ ಚಿಕ್ಕದು ಆದ್ರೆ ಇಷ್ಟು ಚಿಕ್ಕ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇದು ವೀಕೆಸ್ಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಇಷ್ಟು ಚಿಕ್ಕ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ದೊಡ್ಡ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಗ್ರಹಗಳನ್ನು ಹೇಗೆ ಎಳೆಯುತ್ತದೆ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಕಾರಣ ಏನಂದ್ರೆ ಮಾಸ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆದ್ರೆ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಚಿಕ್ಕ ಮಾಸ್ ಚಿಕ್ಕದಿರುವಾಗ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಆದ್ರಿಂದ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಡಿಪೆಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಮಾಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಮಾಸಸ್ ಬಾಡೀಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಹೈಯರ್ ಮಾಸಸ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಹೈಯರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಇನ್ ಜನರಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ವೀಕೆಸ್ಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ನೇಚರ್ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ಇಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರೋಮ್ಯಾಗ್ನೆಟಿಕ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರೋಮ್ಯಾಗ್ನೆಟಿಕ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಟೂ ಚಾರ್ಜ್ಡ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ positive and negative two types of charges are there and we know like charges repel and unlike charges attract so there is force between any two charges either attractive force or repulsive force so this electromagnetic force deals with the force between charged particles these particles may be small and range of this force is also large let us see if we suspend two spheres one with negative charge and another with positive charge if we freely suspend it positive charge attracts negative charge and they come together as shown in the first diagram, then if the spheres are charged with like charges, means if both are negative they repel each other, if both are positive they repel each other as shown in this diagram. And this force of attraction or repulsion depends on the magnitude of the force, magnitude of the charges. Just like mass in the case of gravitational force, here there is magnitude of charges. So here also the force is similarly explained. Force between two charges is directly proportional to the product of the charges, magnitude of charges, and inversely proportional to square of the distance. So electromagnetic force and gravitational force, their definitions almost similar, but they are completely different. This is only, this is either attraction or repulsion. Gravitational force is always attractive, and range of gravitational force is highest. We can say it is infinity, up to infinity it can extend. Because you know, our earth attracts every object. It attracts moon, which is 384,000 kilometers away from the earth. From such a large distance, earth attracts moon means, earth's gravitational force attracts up to moon also. It extends up to moon also. And what about other astronomical objects? If the mass is more, means the range is also more. So gravitational force is having highest range. Then third one is strong nuclear force. Strong nuclear force is the force which binds protons and neutrons in the nucleus. And this is the strongest force in nature. Now we shall see how it is strongest force in nature. For this, let me explain it properly using another slide. See, we know nucleus is at the center and electrons are revolving around the nucleus. Protons and neutrons are sitting inside the nucleus close to each other. How it is possible? Actually, protons are positively charged. There is force of repulsion between them. Then how they can sit together? They cannot sit together unless they are forced to sit together by applying a force. And this force itself is strong nuclear force. So strong nuclear force is the force which bonds the electron together in a small nucleus. That is why it is very strong. It should overcome the repulsive electromagnetic force. That is why it is strong. But its range is very small. Its range is very small and it is of the order of 10 to the power minus 15 meter. It is having such a small range. Then weak nuclear force, fourth type of fundamental force in nature is weak nuclear force. It is a force which appears only in certain nuclear processes such as beta decay of nucleus. Beta decay, there is a process called beta decay in which electrons come out of the nucleus. You may surprise if I say electron is coming out of the nucleus, because electron is not inside the nucleus. Electrons are surrounding the nucleus. Inside the nucleus there are only protons and neutrons. Then how electron can come out from the nucleus? Electron can come out from the nucleus only by a special process called beta decay. And during this beta decay, I am not explaining what is beta decay now. This is only as an example I am giving. So you will study all these things later. During beta decay, beta means actually beta ray means it is fast electron. Fast electron is coming out, fast moving electron. At the same time, a neutrino is emitted. Gamma ray is emitted. This is called beta decay. During this process, for this process, weak nuclear force is needed. Iga strong nuclear force matte weak nuclear force anta nanu heli aitu. Idralli strong nuclear force andre protons matte neutrons annu bahala chikka nucleus ina olage gattiyagi hattira hattira kutkolluva hage maduvantadu. Idu tumba strong irbeku, adrinda idu strong nuclear force. Matte weak nuclear force andre astu strong bekantilla, idu ee reaction ge bekada. ಇದರದ್ದು ರೇಂಜ್ ಕೂಡ ತುಂಬಾ ಕಡಿಮೆ, 10⁻⁶ ಇದು ಈ ವೀಕ್ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್. ಇದು ರೇಂಜ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ವೀಕ್ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ 10⁻⁶ ಮೀಟರ್. ಇಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ವೆರಿ ಶಾರ್ಟೆಸ್ಟ್ ರೇಂಜ್. ಸೊ ದಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ಫೋರ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್: ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್, ನ್ಯಾಚುರಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್, ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್. Then now the tendency is to for the unification of different forces. It is the basic question in physics. So scientists are trying for unification, because every phenomenon should be explained using a single force. This is the wish of the scientists. So scientists are trying to unify these four forces. Recently, electromagnetic force and weak nuclear forces are unified and considered as electro-weak force. Electromagnetic force matte weak nuclear forces annu serisi iga electro-weak force anta heli madlikke vigyanigalige agide. Scientists are trying to unify electro-weak and the strong nuclear force. ಈಗ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರೋ ವೀಕ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗಿದೆ, ಅದು ಅದರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗ್ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನು ಸೇರಿಸಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಉಳಿದದ್ದು ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್. ಆ ಗ್ರಾವಿಟೇಷನಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಈ ಉಳಿದ ಮೂರು ಫೋರ್ಸಿನ ಜೊತೆ ಸೇರಿಸಿ ಒಂದೇ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಫುಲ್ ಯುನಿಫಿಕೇಶನ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಿಗಳು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆರ್ ಟ್ರೈಯಿಂಗ್ to unify gravitational force also with the rest of fundamental forces. Means single unified force scientists are trying to get, then it will be easy for explaining different phenomena. Let us wait and see when it is possible to unify all types of forces together. Then let us see nature of physical laws. See, in physics there are different laws. You have seen some laws in high school also. In PUC also you will see different laws. And many laws are conservative laws, means with the time they are not changing. For example, conservation of energy, conservation of mass, all these things you have seen in classical physics. Time to time it is not changing. Also place to place they are not changing. So different laws in physics are conserved with the time, and also they remain same for any place. For example, suppose a person is weighing 60 kg on earth. Same person, if lands on moon, weighs only 10 kg. But here, weight means what? Gravitational force. Gravitational force on earth and moon may be different, but the law behind it is one and the same. So, gravitational law or any conservation law or whatever may be, it won't change from place to place. Also, it won't change from time to time. So in classical physics, conservation law applies to energy and mass. But in modern physics, what happens? I already told you about the relativity in the last class, theory of relativity. According to theory of relativity, mass can be converted into energy, and this famous formula E is equal to mc square was given by Einstein. Nodi physics nalli bere bere conservation laws anta irthade, andre law of conservation of energy andre energy total energy ottu energy yavaglu sthiravagirthade anta heli law of conservation of energy. Hage law of conservation of mass dravyarashi ಒಂದು ಯಾವುದೇ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮಿನ ದ್ರವ್ಯರಾಶಿ ಟೈಮ್ ಚೇಂಜ್ ಆದರೆ ಚೇಂಜ್ ಆಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಯಾವುದೇ ರಿಯಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಇಂದ ಚೇಂಜ್ ಆಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಹೈಸ್ಕೂಲ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿದ್ದೀರಿ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಷನ್ ಲಾಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳೋದು. ಇಂಥ ಕನ್ಸರ್ವೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಎನರ್ಜಿ, ಮಾಸ್ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕ್ಲಾಸಿಕಲ್ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಬರ್ತದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಮಾಡರ್ನ್ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗುವಾಗ ಐನ್ಸ್ಟೀನ್ನ ಫಾರ್ಮುಲಾ ಇ ಇಸ್ ಈಕ್ವಲ್ ಟು ಎಂ ಸಿ ಸ್ಕ್ವೇರ್ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸಿ ಮಾಸ್ ಎಂ ಅನ್ನು ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಇ ಆಗಿ ಕನ್ವರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕಾಗ್ತದೆ. Mass m can be converted into energy e, means energy and mass are not conserved separately, but total mass and energy are conserved. This is the speciality of modern physics. So nature of physical laws changes from classical physics to modern physics like this. Then we shall see some scientists who have contributed for development of science. Now science is developed so much, physics is developed so much, technology is developed so much. Because of whom? Because of different scientists. So let me introduce you some of the scientists. One is famous scientist Albert Einstein, who proposed theory of relativity, and also he explained photoelectric effect. And for the theory of photoelectric effect, he got Nobel Prize in physics. Then C.V. Raman, Indian scientist C.V. Raman, his contribution to physics is very great. He also got Nobel Prize for his theory on scattering of light. His Raman effect is very famous, you know. Then S.N. Bose, another Indian scientist. He is famous for quantum statistics. His contribution is also great for theoretical physics. Then James Chadwick discovered neutron. W.K. Rontgen discovered X-rays. Discovery of X-ray is also a big boon to the society. This is possible because of discovery of electrons by Rontgen. Then electron, which is a basic particle, was discovered by J.J. Thomson. Thus, many scientists like this have discovered many, many things, many, many phenomena were explained using this. Hige bere bere vijnanigalu bere bere anveshane madidrinda bere bere vishayagalannu kandu hididadrinda ನಮ್ಮ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೆಳೆಯಿತು, ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೆಳೆಯಿತು, ಅದರಿಂದ ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕತೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೆಳೆಯಿತು, ಅದರಿಂದ ಸಮಾಜಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯೋಜನ ಆಯಿತು. ಇನ್ನು ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ ತುಂಬ ಜನ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಬುಕ್ಕಲ್ಲಿ ಕೆಲವು ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ದು ಲೀಸ್ಟ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದೆ, ಅದನ್ನು ನೋಡಿ. ಬೇರೆ ನೀವು ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬುಕ್ಸ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಇಂಟರ್ನೆಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ನೋಡಿದರೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ತದೆ. ಇದು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದು ಬಹಳ ಕುತೂಹಲಕಾರಿ. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಟು ನೋ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್. ಸೊ ಯು ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ನೋ more and more about different scientists and see how physics is developed so much, then it is really interesting. Different scientists have discovered different things. Because of the contribution of all these scientists, science is developed so much. So I have told you only about a few scientists. So it is interesting to know about other scientists also. In your textbook, some list of scientists is given. You can go to websites or any books to know more about scientists. So try to know the life and contribution of scientists. Then it is very interesting. Then you will clearly know how science is developed so much because of the effort of different scientists. ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಿಗಳು ಏನನ್ನು ಕಂಡುಹಿಡಿದಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ನಾನು ಕೆಲವನ್ನು ಮಾತ್ರ ನಿಮಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ನೀವು ಕೆಲವು ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಬುಕ್ಕಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿ, ವೆಬ್ಸೈಟಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬುಕ್ಸ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿ, ನೀವು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಬಹುದು. ಅದು ತುಂಬ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಆಗ ನಿಮಗೆ ಫಿಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಎಷ್ಟು ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗ್ತದೆ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.